All right, here we go. Let's get back to the action. Hopefully most and everybody is back. So you guys wake up, you have an uneventful night. I assume maybe a couple of you were on watch throughout the night, but nothing accost you on the road. And you pick back up in the morning and you continue on your way to Tribor. And we'll say the day goes by pretty quickly. And towards the end of the day, you can see Tribor just up ahead of you. And let's have everybody maybe make a history check, and we'll see who knows information about Tribor that they could have shared with the group. So Ardrith has obviously been here before. Greybeard's been here before. Jarl, you probably have heard of it. And you guys probably will give each other this information, so I'll just kind of read it off. But throughout your discussions throughout the day, Ardrith kind of describing a little bit about what it was like when he was there before and Greybeard being there. You guys know that it's a bustling mercantile town. Tribor stands where the Long Road meets the Evermore Way, so it's basically sitting in a crossroads. Tribor's name is thought to have come from a traveler's tale of slaying three boars here in the same day over 400 winters ago. The town is built on a flat, fertile land with a few natural rises here and there. Nearly half of Tribor's population lives outside the town proper on sprawling ranches and neighboring farmsteads, most of which lie to the north and the east. One thing that Finn puts in information-wise is he knows the current Lord Protector of Tribor is a good-natured ex-adventurer named Darithra Shendrell. I'll put the name in chat here real quick. I don't know if you share this, but I'll just go ahead and tell you now, Finn, you do know her as a harper. I don't know if you tell anybody that or not. Tribor is a market for horses raised by nearby ranches. There's a lot of horse ranches around this area. The town is filled with blacksmiths, harness makers, and wagon works also flourish in the town. In addition to a number of guides that operate out of Tribor, they take merchants and other travelers all over the Sword Coast, typically for stiff fees. And that's kind of the general information that you have. Greybeard and Ardrith also know of a few of the different, probably, inns. You know... And I'll move us to the Tribor map here in just a second. Each one of you have either known or have stayed at the North Shield House, the Six Windows, the Ever Wyvern House, or there's also places that you can set up a camp inside town. And they kind of mention that you know, they've either been to these places or they've stayed at them or Ardrith has performed at them or something like that. So you guys have a notion of a few of the places that are here in town. And you're approaching it towards dusk. And let me go ahead and move our group over.
Is there one that I have a more fond memory of having played at?
Well, I'll give you a little description here of each one of them here in just a sec, and then you can kind of decide that.
I will mention Coffee and I actually saved the lives of the Fulbert family, who apparently own an inn in Tribor, with now Bowdry Proudmead is going to be their brewer. He came up from Daggersford, and we met them on the road and saved them from a little bit of trouble. That would be a reasonable place to put up, I think.
let's cash in that.
That's right.
All right, let me just move some things around here.
I don't have the inn name, though. Do you?
Yeah, I don't remember it.
Just have to ask around for the... Maybe someone in town will know.
There we go. All right, we'll move you guys over to Tribor. And there you go. All right. Are you guys able to see the map?
Yep.
I was expecting much more. I don't know why. But
much more map?
Yeah.
Much more city.
Yeah. I was thinking more city, yeah.
Seems pretty big to me. Okay.
They already have walls.
No, they don't. All right. So, just to give you a few things here. So let me look up. So the North Shield House. So Ardrith kind of tells you guys about the North Shield House. He's been there before. It's a fine local inn, stately, clean, and quiet. You've played there before, and it was kind of like a nicer inn of the place. You also had stayed or played at what was called the Six Windows, and that is like a chilly, creaky, kind of decrepit wooden rooming house, and it's obviously for those that don't have enough money or kind of the lower class people that are traveling through might stay at this place because it's a lot cheaper, and it's definitely a lot more run down. And then there is the Ever Wyvern House is a very expensive inn, and it kind of caters to Waterhavian nobility that come to Tribor, and it's definitely the very rich, kind of elegant foppery type inn and establishment. So it's definitely on the very high end, very expensive list. And none of those three, those have been there a while. Ardrith doesn't know of Landgrave Fulbert's or Bodrey Proudmead's. You guys, because they were on their way to buy an inn, but they hadn't done that yet, so you don't know what they were buying or where they were setting up shop or anything like that. As you're coming in from the south side of town, some of the first buildings you see are just cottages and homesteads along the road. You kind of, as you travel north, you do pass what is a cemetery on the southern end, and you can see that there's elevation. The land kind of rises up, so a lot of the town is up on a 30-foot kind of plateau, as you can see the marks of the elevation there as you guys begin to come into town. Let's move you. So you see a couple of cottages. I'm just going to move everybody up. You do see different foot traffic and wagons and such. But it's getting towards to be, you know, where the sun is starting to set. So a lot of farmers are either heading back out to farms. The cottages, you can see lights in, but there's nobody in the fields at this point. It does seem like there's more people moving around towards the center of town as you're getting closer to the center of town. Go ahead.
What's the name of the second inn again?
So you've been at the North Shield House, which was a decent inn. The Six Windows, which is more of the cheap kind of place.
Right.
And then the real expensive place was the Ever Wyvern House. And you know... Oh, go ahead.
Since I'm kind of close to Greybeard, I'll go Greybeard. There's many a fine inn here, but I've played before at the Six Windows, and rumor has it there that a couple of the barmaids are partial to dwarfs, if you want to join me for a drink.
What better reason to go? And I nudge him like elbow to the ribs kind of thing.
And actually, your role was good enough too that you've been here before, Greybeard, and you know the different inns that are here also. You know that the Six Windows is, if you're looking at the map, I'm going to go ahead and ping it. You have to be zoomed way out to probably see it. It's, you'll have to go in through town and then you'll head to the northwest, and it's this building way up here is the Six Windows building. You also know that this building here that I'm pinging, this is over to the east of the town square. This is where the North Shield House is. And then to the south of the town square, this big elaborate building down here, and it's even got like a park and pathways and stuff. This whole area down here, these buildings are the Ever Wyvern House. So the really expensive area. So as you begin to move into town, the next building you see a sign on this building here that you're passing, this very first one that you guys are at. I'll move you up. So on your right-hand side, you see a building that looks like it's been newly rebuilt. Out on the outside, it has a sign, and it says the Tribor Arms. And it, it's a tap room, and you do see a tiefling kind of standing in the door, leaning against the door edge. It's a tavern, popular hangout amongst rangers and scouts and those who sell their services as wilderness guides and such. So you have the Tribor Arm Tavern. This is the first thing you guys see as you're walking into town. You can hear people in there sitting down for evening meals or starting their evening drinking. You guys want to continue? Off to your left, let me tell you what you see off to your left. Then you guys can tell me what you want to do. It's a wide open paddock that looks like it's a big fence for horse pasture. And it appears to be a horse ranch right here is a large ranch. And there's a sign that sits out here that you guys can see. That says it's the Happy Horse Ranch. It's obviously a place where they sell and barter and trade horses. And it's a big field here that you see. No horses are in it currently. But it is a giant kind of horse field. So you guys are at that point. What do you want to do? Continue on, go into a building, go somewhere.
Well, I'll ask any of the others if they want to head to the Six Windows.
Yeah, I think we should just head to an inn. We can explore tomorrow in the moor.
The ones that have been here before, who were they? Was Ardrith?
Mm-hmm.
And Greybeard.
And Greybeard, yeah. So I'm going to go with Ardrith, whatever his guidance is.
And I tell him, the Six Windows isn't the nicest place in the town, but it is the place where you'll have the most fun.
Okay. So just kind of hurry there, not really stopping to do anything else?
Yeah. You said it's almost night, right?
Well, yeah, the sun is setting, so, yep.
Obviously, I'll need new clothes tomorrow.
I
All right, we'll zoom in so our audience can see where we're at. We're zoomed pretty far out. So you guys come up on a building here. Let's go to the six windows. So it's a, and as you kind of walk in the front door here, it's a kind of a chilly, creaking, decrepit wooden rooming house. You see a female sitting at a table that's at the front, and she kind of looks up as you walk in. Yeah, it's a giant, and it gets its name obviously from the giant windows that are in this building. It's obviously an old building, not very well kept. The middle-aged woman, as you guys walk in, introduces herself as Tomara Hystryn, H-Y-S-S-T-R-Y-N. So Tomara Hystryn, and she kind of looks you up and down and asks you, "Are you looking for a room?"
Set a room and drink and food.
She says, "Well, we definitely can give you a bunk. There's plenty of room here tonight." I don't think she has a tavern, though.
What?
Well, it looks like my knowledge of the town wasn't as good as we thought.
Yeah, it's just kind of a boarding. It's a rooming house, so a place to stay. Right, she can serve food. But there's no actual tavern here.
Gotcha. So Jarl will turn to Ardrith and say, "I thought you said that there was fun."
I thought the DM said there were three taverns in town, and I picked one.
Well, three inns, yeah.
Let's just slowly back out the door to the
some
road.
Place where there's a drink. So do I actually remember which of the places in town was fun?
Yeah, you're probably the North Shield House, probably that first tavern you saw on the way in, which was the Tribor Arms. Yeah.
Okay. Well, see if there's anything else. Walk there, or I redirected us early on when we came into town.
Yeah, you remember the Ever Wyvern House being just stuffy and full of, you know, lords and ladies.
Okay.
I'm just looking to see if there's anything else. Now that would be the places that you remember.
Okay. Well, we'll head back to the one that the module says is the most entertaining.
Well, the module doesn't say anything about entertaining.
Dagnabbit. Well,
that's a queen.
No, that's right. Yeah, she's Queen Dagnabbit.
She's not here.
Right. So to the inn or to the tavern?
Sure. We'll go to the inn. The first one we came across.
Okay, so that's just a tavern.
Okay. As long as it's got booze.
All right, yeah, so you guys pile into this building here. I'll just put us close to it. You guys are in this building right here. Yeah, and as you come up to the door, there's a tiefling standing in the doorway with an easy smile. And he kind of motions you in. He holds the door open. And welcomes you to the Tribor Arms. He introduces himself as Nemyth, N-E-M-Y-T-H. And there's lots of, you know, there's lots of drinking going on. There's food. You can smell food. And when you get in there, you do see a lot of patrons. And a lot of these patrons are dressed very similar to Ian, so very woodsy type people, rangers and scout type, so leathers and cloaks and guides and things like that, wilderness guides, those kind of group. And you guys quickly find a empty table and are able to order up food and drink if you wish.
Big plate of eels, please.
Okay. We can use the same other menu we had, I suppose, just to keep it easy. So if you want anything, you can just order it from the menu and then minus that money from your cash total.
Bacon, pork pie, sausage, and gravy, a pitcher of mead, a pitcher of stout. Oh, two orders of bacon. That sounds about right. And then these guys will have something too.
Awesome. All right. And after probably about 10 to 15 minutes, some of that stuff starts coming to your table. You notice that the staff here seem to be pretty cordial, kind of clean. So it's definitely a nicer place.
I'll ask up at the bar if anybody knows about the Fulberts or Bowdry Proudmead. They'd have just gotten into town a few days ago, probably, right? I mean, they weren't too terribly far ahead of us.
Yeah, yeah. So Nemeth, who was the tiefling that kind of held the door open for you, and you notice that he, by the time you go up to the bar, he's back there and he's cleaning out a mug with a rag, the typical tavern owner animation type thing. And he says, Fulbert, Proudmead, I'm pretty sure they're here in town, but I'm not sure where they're at the moment. I think they've only been here, like you said, just a few days. You'll have to ask around. I'm not sure where they're staying.
Who are we supposed to take the money and the notice to as well?
You would be taking them to the Featherstone family, and you guys have been... you're looking for a... Marcus and Florencia Featherstone is who you're supposed to deliver that to. Marcos and Florencia.
Does he know where they are?
Yeah, he says they live out on out just northwest of town. So if you take the Evermore Road out past Six Windows, you will find it's right near Six Windows. They live in a cottage that is kind of right in that area. You should be able to find them. That's where the Featherstones live.
All right, thank you very much.
Okay. If you have your map zoomed out, I'll ping the house. It's this house here. So it's the house directly south of the Six Windows. So you guys actually passed it twice now.
All right.
All right, anything else? Party the night away or just have dinner and then what?
I will sing if Ardreth will accompany and play.
Of course.
Ooh, nice. Were there rooms here?
Nope, this is just a tavern. So either...
places we can sleep out around the town, or we could find an inn.
Yeah, yeah. So the six windows is a place where you can get a room. You can get a room at the North Shield House. You could try to get a room at the Ever Wyvern House. But there's also two areas that you guys have passed in the center where a lot of these caravans bring their wagons in, and you're able to set up a tent or camp. So they have like little camping areas. If you're looking at the map and you're zoomed out a little bit, this area here. And this area here is where caravans set up, and then like a lot of the people that stay with the caravans just set up their like a campsite here, right here in town, if they don't want to get a room in an actual place to save money. So there's people that have set up little camps in those two areas. So this one and this one.
Well, I certainly don't mind sleeping outside, but we are in a town. Might as well get room somewhere. Even if it's the bunkhouse, I don't care.
Right, I might sleep under that table over there.
I'm good with finding a spot outdoors in the town area, in the center area.
Yeah, I'm about that life.
All right. Ian, you kind of notice you're seeing a lot of rangery type folk, and you're hearing them talk, and you do hear a couple of them talking about place where, let me see, let me go back over. You overhear this. Nope. Where is it? Oh, it's that one. Okay. There's a lot of buildings here. Give me a second.
That's fine.
You hear of Garon Slumber. And you notice, you recognize the name Garon, G-W-A-E-R-O-N, is the god of tracking. And a lot of times people, there's apparently a mystical forest just north of town. And lots of the rangers and guides will end up sleeping in that woods. And a lot of people will go there just to try to commune with the gods, either Maliki or Garon. And if you've got, if you're zoomed out a little bit, it's to the northwest of you. It's this kind of copse of trees is considered the Garon Slumber. And nobody chops these trees down. Nobody does anything to these. It's kind of, you hear some of the rangers and the scouts talking about it as a sacred place for the goddess of forest and the goddess of and the god of tracking.
These ones over here?
Yep, these ones here.
The ones behind okay. The six windows.
Right, okay. Gotcha.
Cool. I tell, who's my other nature-y person? Finn, right? I'll tell Finn about it.
Okay.
He's also interested in. I say it's where Greybeard cannot hear me. Because I hear sacred and I hear Greybeard and I'm like, that's a place he doesn't need to go.
Poor Greybeard. Violet. Everybody picks on Greybeard. That's what happens when you're in a group of elves and half elves. So bunch, snobs.
Bunch of racists.
All right, well, go ahead and move yourself to where you guys want to go for the evening.
Oh, I just zoomed in. There we go.
Are we splitting up or are we all together?
I'm going to sleep outside.
I'm going to sleep outside, but I need to get a bath first.
I'm going to sleep outside, too. They got a river here.
So I had to step away. Why are we not staying in then?
Because we can stay outdoors.
Oh, okay.
Because
okay.
I've been on the cloud for the past week. I need solid, safe ground.
Coffee and Finn, as you're sitting in there, give me a perception check in that. This is during dinner. Not relevant to where you're sleeping or anything like that. But go ahead and give me a perception check on why you were having dinner. All right, yeah. Actually, both of you pick it up then. You notice somebody that you actually have met before. It's a half-elf. She's dressed in scout clothing. And you recognize her as part of the group that you guys are a part of. And you have seen her before out in the Isles. And you know her name to be Zindra Winterbow. And so you guys would know her being part of the Emerald Enclave.
She's in the tavern?
Yeah, you recognize... some of the symbols that are typically hidden amongst the gear that they wear, but somebody who's, you know, has worked with the Emerald Enclave before recognize those symbols when they see them. So this is the person that and this is the person that you would probably report back to about giant incursions and things, any things that you guys would have found, because you guys had done a lot of talking to different Enclave members when you were south of Waterdeep, so you're kind of used to looking for agents of that group. And she's just having dinner and talking to people in there. She doesn't really recognize you guys or even see you. And you know, you've seen her before. You probably haven't like formally met her, but you've definitely seen her around in the enclave areas. And then maybe have even crossed paths before. And it was Zindra Winterbow. Half elven female.
I will, I'll buy her a drink and go talk to her.
Oh, okay.
Did it report in?
Yeah.
Yeah, so you guys kind of do the hand signals and she then recognizes some of the symbols from your guys' armor. And actually, maybe there's even a little bit of recognition, like you guys have seen each other in the hallways before or have bumped into each other at some other point. And she doesn't quite remember your names, but when you say your name, she's like, oh, that's right, I remember you now. And yeah, so she accepts your drink and you guys kind of sit in a quarter table and she kind of asks the friends that were there, if she could have a moment, and they kind of drift off and they go to the bar to get some more food and drink. And then you three are kind of sitting at a table. And she's like, well, what brings you to Tribor?
I guess we should give her all the information that we've gathered over the past couple of weeks in terms of the giants.
Yeah. Debrief.
And Nightstone.
Okay, yeah, and she actually takes out a small notebook when she realizes that you guys are, you know, it's not just like a social call or a say hello, it's like, oh, information. And she kind of writes down the pertinent information and kind of like a scribble. That's like a cipher code. And she's like, all right, I will make sure that I send this back to the Enclave so they have this information.
Ask if there's anything she knows going on locally that would help with that endeavor.
Yeah, and she's like, it's interesting you ask. You know, I typically serve as a guide here in town for anybody that comes in and wants to go out to the surrounding areas. And one of the things I've noticed is I'm having to kind of lead my groups around a lot more hill giants and ogres and Uthgart barbarians that seem to be wandering the hills in a kind of near Tribor, not close enough for anything, you know, to get too close, but she's definitely had to be careful with the groups that she's guiding around to the different areas. You guys know, and she kind of tells you that it's pretty common for people to come here and then get guides and go to the east. There's kind of like, if I go back to the map, let me look at it.
What's an Uthgart barbarian?
I think they're human.
Yeah, yep. Yeah, just like a savage human kind of tribe of barbarians. The Deserine Hills are to the east of you guys and south of Yarder, which is the other town. And that area is a pretty common area for adventurers to try to go and find adventure and stuff. There's a lot of history there. There's a lot of ruins that can be found throughout there. And so a lot of groups come here, and then she works as a guide to show them through different places, all through this, over near the Deserine River and the Deserine Hills.
And we've given her the info that Zephyros gave us too, right? About the Ordning and all the stuff going on.
So far I've assumed you've given her everything about Nightstone and everything you found on the road. I didn't know if you gave her anything about the giant himself or any of that. That's up to you guys.
It's pertinent given that he's given us a lot of information on what's actually causing the giants to be active.
Okay. Yeah, and she writes that, she makes sure she writes that down, and she's like, this is going to be a lot of information I'm sending back, but this is great. You guys have done a really good job. Check back with me, she says, in a week or so, and I'll find out if, you know, if they've sent back any other further instructions or if any new information has come back. I'll share it with you guys.
Should make sure that she knows that the giant in the tower with the gigantic blue starry hat is not dangerous. So I don't know if the Emerald Enclave is mounting any attacks like the Lord's Alliance are, but he's not dangerous.
Yeah, and she's interested in knowing that that you guys have talked with some Lord's Alliance and that you kind of have heard that they're out there, you know, ambushing these fortresses that are out there. She says she makes sure she'll pass that information on also. So, okay. Anything else?
Does she know where the Fulbrights are?
She does not. She has not heard of Landgrave Fulbert or Bodri Proudmead.
Okay.
All right. So, Greybeard, you're just going to drink your way through the night at the tavern there?
It's all about drinking and arm wrestling.
All right. Awesome. The only other person I haven't seen move yet then is Jarl and Coffee. Where are you guys going as far as the rest of the evening?
I'm going to stay at the tavern watching Greybeard.
Okay.
That's kind of creepy.
Jarl? You're muted if you're talking.
He's watching coffee. Watching
Yeah. Yeah, he said BRB a while ago.
Oh, there you go.
Alright.
I'm definitely still getting a bath at some point in time this evening. Washing the stink of 2 weeks of road off me.
Yeah, is there... Where would you do that? Probably at either Six Windows.
The pond.
There is a pond here in the middle of town.
You got a pool.
I don't know how clean that is.
Good for you.
Let's go jump right in the middle of town square in the pond.
Town's drinking water.
Exactly.
All right, so a lot of you are staying up in the... Garon's slumber, huh? All right. So the next fun part. Yeah, I think that's what'll happen.
That sounds great. Sounds like great news for us.
And a dragon.
And suddenly, a red chromatic dragon.
And you did know, when you were talking to, or you overheard those scouts and those rangers, Ian, they all did mention that everybody tries to avoid angering Garon. It's forbidden to cut any wood from those trees or hunting any creatures in those woods.
Say as much to my friends who came with me.
And when you guys get over there, you notice these trees, which are different than the other ones, they are all in a state of autumnal colors. So all of the leaves are in dazzling shades of yellow, orange, and red, which is different than any of the other trees that you've seen in town or around. And you feel a presence of, you know, a peacefulness as you enter those woods.
I'm like in a mourn by all of these woods. It reminds me slightly of home.
All right.
I just walk around like sort of in awe and respect of the land and Garon slumber. Being very respectful about where I'm standing and where I'm stepping. Careful not to disturb too much.
Okay.
lean my pack up against a tree.
Right. Yeah, and you're all pretty close together, right?
Ideally, sure, yes.
Yeah. Yeah. You did notice while you were going up there, you see one other ranger that's out there. They're a ways from you, but also was putting like a sleeping blanket down on the ground. And then there was one other scout that you noticed that's out there too. And they definitely are a ways from each other, and they are also actually out there too. They have their sleeping blankets down, but they're also kind of in a meditative state. Obviously, you know, either praying or just meditating in the very peaceful woods. How close do you want to be to any one of them? Do you want to be far enough that you don't even see them? You want to be...
just a respectful amount away from them.
Okay.
Give them their space, have our space.
Yeah, okay.
There's enough trees here for everybody.
Yeah.
All right. Jarl, make it back yet?
I'm back.
Okay. You were the only one I didn't hear of how you were spending your evening or where you were spending it.
I mean, if people are gathering together, then that's where I'll be.
Well, two of them are in the tavern and three of them are in the woods.
Who's in the tavern?
Greybeard and Coffee.
I'll spend it in the woods.
I look very sternly at Jarl when he's with us, and I am very explicit about the rules of how to treat nature.
I am but the simple man. I treat everything with respect.
All right. So the tavern gets pretty rowdy throughout the evening, especially as it gets to be about like that 8, maybe that 9 or 10 o'clock at night. The drinking's going on pretty well right up until midnight, 2 o'clock. Most of the people are super drunk by then, and they've either wandered off to go back home, go back to where they're going to sleep. Only the very hardcore drinkers are left by 1 or 2 in the morning. I assume Greybeard's still going strong at that point?
Oh, it's in my profile. Once I start drinking, it's hard for me to stop.
Okay. And there's definitely a lot fewer people here now, but it's definitely the adept at drinking are left. Coffee, you've been there most of the evening, and you know, there's been plenty of entertainment and stuff going on. You could have talked to any of the other people. It's definitely a pretty, you know, boisterous crowd and happy kind of go lucky things. The group in the woods, do you just go to sleep once you get out there? Is there somebody on watch? What's going on? Are you guys having conversations or ignoring each other? What?
I will trust to our ultra keen ranger to alert us for, or at least me, and I will go to sleep.
Sleep sounds good.
Yeah, I'm gonna be awake a while, just appreciating the land. And he is not my god, but my god is a friend of them, so I will be praying to my god.
Okay.
Just, you know, really just, it's sort of like when you lay down at night and you look up at the stars and you just stay there for a while staring at the stars for a weird amount of time. I do the same thing, but instead with the trees. Instead of looking up, I'm looking at the trees.
Yeah, and you are fascinated with the idea that these are in perpetual autumn, and the colors are vibrant, and the trees have just a really different feeling to them than, you know, it's a forest that really kind of brings a lot of different emotions to you, different than, say, other woods and forests that you've been in.
Yeah.
And then Jarl?
Jarl's gonna, like, he gets the sense that there's like a quiet around the place or in this area, so he's gonna meditate and kind of consider the last few days. For him, it's been pretty jarring, just with the monastery, and then, you know, ending up in a floating fortress. So he's just trying to make sense of the last couple of days. He's used the calm and the quiet just to kind of reflect on that. And, you know, he's kind of got half an eye on the surroundings just because it's a different area, but he's enjoying and reflecting in the quiet.
Okay. So the night passes. I will need one check from Ian. Give me one perception check for the evening.
Oh, the only time I ever get a good roll. Who knows when it'll pop up for you, but it was a natural 20 and a 24.
Ooh, nice. Wasn't expecting that.
Neither was I. That never happens to me.
All right, towards the middle of the evening, you think you hear a commotion to the southwest of you. It's subtle, it's quiet, but it stands out because you're in such a peaceful area. And as you think about it, yeah, I haven't seen your roll yet, but I'm assuming it's coming any second. As you think about it, you think it's coming from where you happen to have seen the ranger was kind of staying. So it's out of view, but you knew you passed them as you guys were coming to find your spot for your camp, and you'd pass this ranger that was meditating, and you think this subtle rustling, this subtle commotion of some sort is coming from the direction you remember seeing that ranger in. And it's probably 3 a.m., and everybody's probably sleeping around you or meditating around you at the moment. And you don't think, you're not getting like a sense of anything except just the rustling of leaves, or it's just a little louder than anything you've heard, but not by much. It's not like a huge commotion.
Considering the events of the past few days, I'm just going to be an alert. This is a new town. I've never been to this town. I don't know what's around this town. So I immediately go over to Finn and I shake him awake. And I tell him that I heard something in that general direction, and I'm going to go check it out. And I just didn't want to leave them alone. And I sneak over towards where I heard the commotion. Just to make sure it's not anything dangerous.
And I'll ping it. You guys kind of saw the person that was over in this area. And it's a little ways off. You'd have to, you'd move a little ways to actually find him again. But I'll ping kind of where that direction you'd be going. So kind of south of you guys.
If she goes off, then I'll wake up Ardrith and Jarl quietly.
And I tell Finn that I don't think it's anything, but at this point I'm not willing to take any chances with what's happening in the world.
All right, and how are you going over there?
I am sneaking.
Then give me a stealth check.
Oh, good.
And yeah, I've still not seen your other role, but go ahead.
I'll send you a screenshot later.
I trust you. Yep, stealth check.
One day it'll pop up. It'll pop up. Oh, the little red box just went away. I don't want to click it again. Nope, I got an 8.
Okay.
It'll eventually pop up, I'm sure. Or maybe never. Who knows?
Who knows? Okay. You sneak over there and you find where the bedroll of that ranger was, and you can kind of see where he was meditating. There's kind of like an imprint on the ground of where he was sitting next to his bedroll. But when you get over there, it's just the bedroll, and you don't see the ranger anywhere.
I look around to see if I see anything. If I see the ranger or signs of anybody else.
Looking at what, like, you mean like tracking just, or
no, the ground, like around, or? Just around, just generally before I do anything specific, I just want to look around the area to make sure that, like, he's just not off.
Yeah, you're not seeing anything. Yeah, you're not sure. Well, and if he did, he went further than, you know, you're not seeing anybody. You're far enough that you don't quite see Ardrith, Jarl, and Finn. You've moved far enough south that you don't quite see them either. But you don't see anybody or any creatures or anything around. And you're not hearing anything either. It's all super quiet again. Quiet and peaceful.
Supposedly. So I look at, I start taking a closer look, at the campground to see if the campground, the area he was at, and see if there was any signs of commotion or anything worrisome, I guess is the best way I could describe it.
All right. I believe that's a survival check for kind of like tracking or looking for signs of, like, on the ground, right? You're looking at the ground to find.
Yeah, I'm looking at the ground. I'm looking at where.
Hey, there's perception. What? There's stealth. I just came up.
Hey.
So now we just need a survival check.
Survival. 1, 2. I rolled a 2.
Yeah, you're not really seeing much. I mean, nothing out of the ordinary, nothing that you wouldn't expect to find. You don't really see where the person would have went off to. They're a ranger too, so they're just as capable of walking through the woods without leaving a trace as well as you are.
Would they be considered a humanoid?
They are, yeah, the ranger is a human for sure, yeah.
So would you say that because I'm trying to track them and I did a survival check that because I'm a ranger and they're my favorite enemy, I get advantage on that? That is a feature of it, of being my favorite enemy. But would it apply to this?
Doesn't that feat you took work with that as well?
I don't know what's my feat.
Does it say you get advantage or not? Does it actually say those words?
Additionally, you have advantage on wisdom survival checks to track your favorite enemies, as well as on intelligence checks to recall information about them.
Oh, yes. Yeah, so the 22 would be good then. Okay. You see, and it's very, very subtle, very light. It's obvious somebody had covered the tracks. But you see tracks that move straight west.
Do I only see one set?
Yes, and they're not human.
Oh, shit.
And you're not sure what they are.
Are they large? Or medium?
Sure, I would say they're pretty big.
They're pretty big. Bigger than a human.
Yeah, yeah. But it's not your favorite enemy, so you're not picking up on what that is, or, you know, what it, you've never seen these type of tracks before, so you don't know.
And everything here.
But the thing that stands out is it's obvious that whatever it was, it knows how to cover its tracks, and only because you had that really good roll. Did you find the human tracks were some of the drag marks for the human, but then they stop immediately as if that person had been picked up, and then the tracks disappear completely, and you can tell that something was able to clear its tracks, but it started heading west, and then they just disappear. They're just gone. It hides its tracks.
How long ago was this? Like 5-10 minutes ago now?
You think between the time you came down here and that, what kind of, yeah, I would say maybe 10 minutes of some of the noise you heard, but you don't know if that noise was, I mean, you think the noise was in this general direction, but you weren't sure. I mean, it was a very faint kind of thing.
I look at the things that the ranger had. If there's any sign of, like, an identity or anything that would give me a clue of who they were.
No, there's a pack there. The bow is still leaning up against the tree where the bedroll is, but you're not seeing any like identification or name tags or anything like that. You just remember seeing that person as you guys came up through here, so you kind of remember what that person looks like, but you don't know their name or anything like that.
All right, I headed back up north, back to my group, and I tell them that the ranger that was down there was presumably kidnapped, was taken by something whose tracks I didn't recognize, and they seemed to be very skilled at it, because I barely saw them. And I tell them that I'm going to go find the scout that I saw, that we saw, to warn them about something going knock at the night. Something that might come for them.
Okay, and you remember seeing the scout down here.
Alright, so after I tell them that, I head back down north, south to go find the scout. And, again, I want to be a little bit stealthy heading down, just in case the thing comes back and I'm able to see them before they see me.
Okay, yeah, go ahead and make another stealth roll for this one.
It's going to go great. Hey! I rolled a 20.
Yep. Yeah, so you're able, and you see, you get down there and you see a female scout, person dressed in scout-like clothing, sleeping in a bedroll. And she has not heard you or noticed that you were, have kind of snuck up to her little camp area.
All right, so I do a quick look around to see that there's nothing here that's immediately dangerous.
No, you don't see anything. You don't see anything, you don't hear anything, but she's not even making much noise. She's obviously a person that sleeps in the woods. Obviously a person that somehow, outdoors people know not to make a lot of noise in your sleep, or you wouldn't have survived long being in the woods doing that. And yeah, but you can tell she is sleeping quietly.
Oh man, how can I wake her up without going straight up to her? Like, what is, like, you would have to make some sort of noise, right?
I would think you would purposely, like, step on a twig 20, 30 feet out so that, you know, she would know there's somebody approaching without.
I make a specific sort of, it almost sounds like a bird noise, but it's very purposely not. It's something we would use in our group when we went on scouting missions. And I see if that wakes her up.
Yeah. She's a very, very light sleeper, and she recognizes a different sound. And her breathing changes, but she pretends to be asleep, but you notice that she's slowly drawing a weapon while still pretending to be asleep, and then she kind of opens her eyes and begins to look around as if not wanting to let anything know that she's awake. And then when she doesn't see anything quite yet, she kind of moves to a crouch position, and that's when she kind of sees you to the north of her. And then she kind of gives you a look.
Yeah, and I'm very non-threatening. I have my hands out to make sure she sees I don't have any weapon on me, immediately at least. And how far away am I from her?
That's up to you, how close you want to get.
Probably, like, not that close. So, like, maybe, like, 30 feet.
Okay.
And so I get a little bit closer. And close enough where, at a low voice, I come up to her and I say, just west of here, probably, like, 20 minutes ago now, about 20 minutes ago, I heard a commotion, and I went to go check on it, because it's been a rough couple of weeks. And I went to go check, and the ranger that was there was gone, and I was able to see tracks of something, dragging away somebody, and I just wanted to come and make sure one, that you were still here, and two, to know that there is something out here that wants to take things. And I just wanted to make sure you were aware that something is happening, something dangerous is happening here.
She kind of sheaths her weapons and she says, and she looks at you, and she kind of scanned around the area as you were there, because she at first didn't trust you, was making sure that, you know, she wasn't being surrounded by people. And then as you talk to her, she's like, oh, you must not be from around here. A lot of people come to these woods, and some have claimed to even seen Garon himself walk among these trees. And many rangers and people that have come out here to worship or pay homage to Garon have claimed they've seen Garon within these woods.
Does Garon also drag and carry these people away?
She says, well, there are definitely been those that have come out here seeking his guidance, and then we assume have moved on or have been given some type of quest from him, or has entered his worship in some way. So certainly there are those that have come out here every now and then, and then we haven't seen again.
So they don't come back?
We most people just assume that Garon has given them some quest or mission. Isn't that why you're out here, to seek guidance from Garon?
And to see the forest. Yeah, I've never been here. I'd never heard of this place. I'm fascinated. Yeah, I had no idea that Garon himself walks among these trees. Oh, well, I guess I'm sorry for waking you up. It's just been a very long, arduous past few weeks with the attacks, and I just wanted to make sure anyone would be safe. I'm sorry for waking you up.
And she says, well, let's at least go up and look at, where you saw this ranger. She's like, I didn't see anybody here except for your group who passed by me earlier, but show me where this ranger was.
Okay, so I take her over there, and I show her where they were, and then I show the tracks.
Yeah, and she gets kind of an interesting look on her face, and she's hesitant to say anything, and she just says, it is odd that his bow is still here at the tree, though. And she has kind of a different tone, because she obviously just assumed it was, you know, the typical story of people seeing Garon or Maliki in this woods, which is a pretty common story that gets told down at the tavern quite often. But the idea that the weapon is still there and the person would not have taken it seems to have troubled her some. But she still doesn't. I mean, she doesn't recognize the tracks any more than you do. And then she's like, I think I'm gonna head back into town. And she kind of heads back to get her stuff and is gonna head back into town.
What was her name? Or was it a she?
Yep, and it was Varon Winterborn.
And she was human?
Yeah, she's human, kind of like scout, guide, outdoorsy kind of person. Not necessarily ranger, but kind of in the profession of being a guide. So has those kind of, you know, traveling leathers and kind of a large dagger, had a bow near her gear.
Oh man, I like this town. And so as she leaves, and we say our goodbyes, I head back to our group and I let them know okay. what I learned.
All right, and we'll say that's about 4-ish a.m., 4:30-ish during that time as you come back and explain what you have found. The group in the tavern are still partying away. Greybeard, most of the people are probably snoring on the tables, drunk. Most of that is winding down, and the tavern keep is starting to kick people out. And I think we'll call our session for tonight, and we'll be ready to pick back up in Tribor in our next session. So any last things from our players?
No. Welcome back.
If we get kicked out, we'll go find a room.
Okay. It's probably around 3 when the tavern keep starts kicking everybody out. So you can either sleep in the paddocks, which are where a lot of caravans camp, for free. You just throw down a bedroll and sleep on the ground. Or you can go to one of the places and buy a room if you wish, one of the 3 different places.
Would they still be open?
You probably would be able to wake up the proprietor. They're always going to take your money, especially if you come in at 3 and then you're going to be gone at 6 or 7 or 8 or whatever anyways. They'll still take your money.
Greybeard then, I guess, would wander along. If Coffee's tagging with him, he talks to him, blah, 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 you know. Well, great, no, we should do that more often. How come you didn't have any drinks? And then the closest, whatever inn we come to first, that's where we'll try to get a room, or at least I'll try to get a room. I don't want to talk for Coffee. And if not, I'll wander all the way back around to the 6 windows.
Yeah, the 2 places that you probably, that aren't the real expensive place, are equal distance from each other. So either 6 windows or the North Shield Manor. So either one is equal distance.
I've been to the 6 windows, so I guess I go there.
Okay, yeah. So you guys can move up to the, I'll move you up there to the 6 windows, which is that building there. And it's just a silver piece for a room. And she'll give it to you for the night.
All right, well, I'm going to head out. You guys have a good night. It was fun.
Yep, and we'll call it there. All right, so I'll just... everybody, thanks for joining those in chat. We'll be back again next Monday, and we'll see what happens with Tribor next. There's plenty to go. Plenty, especially if you're watching my screen, you can see some cool stuff that's going to be happening soon. Our players are going to have a lot of fun in this town, I think. So go ahead and cut you off there. If you want to see any of the VODs, you can check them out on the Twitch channel, or you can go to the YouTube channel and catch up on any of the episodes there. I'll try to get those up here pretty quick. Or you can also check out the Player Perspective over at MC Colonel's YouTube channel also. So thanks for joining. I'll leave you on the character screen for just a moment, and we will see you next Monday.